chase is on in Churchill, Manitoba. A 300-kilogram polar bear is on the loose.
What the helicopter's gonna do, there's a nice flat open area behind here. We're gonna try to push him across.
Race to get to the bear before the bear gets to people. In the air and on the ground, a polar bear alert team zeroes in armed with tranquilizer guns. It's a dangerous task. There's a fear the panicked bear could turn and attack. We're told to move fast.
Back to the vehicle.
Right now.
But finally, reluctantly, it goes down for the count.
Did he take a while to go down this one?
Yeah, well, the dart went low in the leg,
yeah.
So it didn't absorb quite as quickly.
In recent years, the bear alert team has found more and more bears coming closer and closer to town.
When they come this close to Churchill, this is a big attraction for them because of the smell. And they root around in the dump looking for food.
Sheer hunger.
The polar bears of Churchill are turning up hungrier each year. The Cree Indians call the polar bear Wapask, white bear. And that's the name of the vast national park in which they live here on Hudson Bay in Canada. Thousands of visitors flock to this region every year for just a glimpse of this majestic animal. But there's now a belief that the very existence of the polar bear in this wilderness is under threat.
Polar bears are really giving us a warning signal that there's something going on, and it's not just polar bears that are in trouble. It could be an entire ecosystem, the entire Arctic marine ecosystem.
Getting ready to take to the air, a research team from the Canadian Wildlife Service. For nearly 40 years, scientists have studied the polar bears of Wapask National Park, building an incredibly detailed database.
I made some blood kits. There's more blood kits, and there is this.
Dr. Nick Lunn on the right has spent 20 years of his life studying the bears. Now a world authority on the mammal, he's deeply worried by what he sees.
But you never know. We have enough anyway.
Bears in this population over the past two decades, which is sort of our best data set, is declining, and that's consistent for adult males, and it's consistent for adult females with cubs.
Each autumn, Dr. Lunn and his team come to the park to carry out tests on the bears.
Over the past 20 years, the bears are losing condition. They're coming ashore lighter and lighter.
Knocked cold, the bear wakes hours later with the equivalent of a hangover. The tests are done now while the bears are on shore during the summer and autumn months.
X19196.
Yeah. Winter is spent on the ice hunting their favourite prey, seals, and they're only forced ashore to fast when the winter ice melts. What troubles Dr. Lunn is his discovery the bears are being forced ashore earlier each year because the ice is melting sooner.
The air temperature in the springtime, since about 1950, when they first started recording and looking at this stuff, has been warming at about 0.2 to 0.3 degrees Celsius per decade. So over the past five decades, that's an increase of anywhere from sort of 1 to 1.5 degrees Celsius warming trend. And this might require some help. I'm not that strong. What we're seeing now is the breakup of the sea ice here in Hudson Bay is occurring about 1.5 to 2 weeks earlier now in the early 2000s than it did in the early 1980s.
Okay, while I'm here, have a look at his canines.
For the bears of Wapusk, the early breakup of ice has had a dramatic effect.
There's a little bit of vegetation in his teeth. They're feeding.
Historically, those last weeks of feeding before the ice melts are when the bears find the bulk of their prey, newborn seal pups.
Well, I feel strongly that what basically is happening is the bears are at the critical feeding time just before they're coming ashore. They have reduced access to seals, so they're simply not able to put on as much fat in the springtime prior to being forced ashore than they used to be.
And you can put your hands here and feel, and you can feel sort of the vertebrae in the back, if you just rub your hands back and forth. And, you know, there's not a lot of fat sort of on the ribs.
For each week the bears come ashore earlier, they arrive 10 kilos lighter, a critical loss of weight for a polar bear about to start a long fast.
Yeah, he's below average and he's got another two and a half months to go. So, I mean, by the time he heads back out on the sea ice, he's probably going to be pretty hungry.
Today, adult males are 30 to 40 kilograms lighter than they were just 15 years ago. The greatest fear is the weight loss may already be affecting females and their ability to produce cubs, and that the cubs that are born are not surviving.
Well, at some point in time, that this population would probably become unviable. It just would not be able to sustain itself here, and you would probably lose this population, or certainly major segments of it.
Wapusk National Park is alive with the animals of the tundra. Scientists believe temperatures are rising in Hudson Bay and throughout the Arctic faster than anywhere else in the world. Mankind, they argue, is causing it, with decades of pollution and greenhouse gases.
I think the rapid rate at which this is occurring, to me, sends some sort of an alarm that this isn't something natural. Usually natural events don't tend to be as dramatic and as rapid as they seem to be, our data seem to suggest they are.
Dr. Lund's theory has powerful support. At NASA, new satellite surveillance research reveals the thickest Arctic ice, called perennial ice, is disappearing at an alarming rate.
And it's retreating at a rapid rate of 9% per decade. So that's quite substantial in terms of rate of decline. And if you project that, then you might lose all that multi-year ice cover within this century.
Neither is his prediction the worst case scenario. There's a belief that less ice means less reflection of the sun's heat, and the growing body of water will get warmer and warmer, in turn speeding up the ice melt.
Some modeling efforts have projected that we lose the ice totally in 50 years.
If true, the change in climate may allow some animals to inhabit areas previously too cold. But it may also mean the loss of other species, like the polar bear.
There are a number of species that depend on ice above and below, and so if we're losing polar bears, we're also probably having effects on those populations, and we may lose more than just bear species, we may lose the whole Arctic marine ecosystem.
But just as scientists are sounding the alarm, skeptics are calling for caution. For Churchill, a town dependent on ecotourism, losing the polar bears would be disastrous. Many don't want to believe what the scientists are saying for fear of what it'll do to tourism and the town.
Yeah, we're not traveling in the smoothest terrain in the world, though.
Merv Gunter is a former banker turned tourism operator.
It's our livelihood. Like, this is our company, Tundra Buggy Tours. We've invested in these over the last 15 years. My wife and I and my son are all involved with the business.
Yeah.
We share those two things.
It's snowy out.
The polar bear part of our business is the key part of what we do. It's probably 95% of our total revenues for our business.
The height of the polar bear season lasts just 6 weeks, but it's enough to sustain a town, a province, all year round.
Churchill actually creates a spin-off benefit of about $130 to $160 million for our province. A big impact is here locally in town.
It's businessmen like Merv who challenge claims the bears may be headed for extinction.
I don't see a decreasing number of bears. I sense a larger number of bears. I talk to our drivers and our guys and I ask how things are going and what's going on out there. And I mean, there's days that you don't see a lot of bears. That's just normal. But an overall reaction to it is that there seems to be all the bears that we used to have or more.
His greatest fear is an attempt to limit access to the bears based on scientific results that are not yet conclusive.
The concern that bothers me the most is people overreacting, becoming alarmist, basing a conclusion on little fact and more assumption and more emotion, and that's not valid.
H1190.
There's support for Merv from an unexpected quarter.
That is wonderful news. Thanks a lot. We've had many, many sightings. This year was a little unusual. It was the earliest the ice has ever broken up. It's the earliest we've ever had bears come out to and in around Churchill and actually stay.
Local conservation supervisor Richard Romanyuk believes the abundant number of bears near town is a good sign.
We're now thinking that the bear population has actually increased. We're considering it to be stable at 1,200 bears, but realistically it could be closer to 1,400 or 1,600. We're not seeing a reduction in the number of bears. So is the population crashing at this present time? The answer is no.
You're getting reports of many, many more bears, for instance, in and around town than you had before. You just haven't seen that before. Now, some people say that's an indication that the population is expanding, that there's just many, many more bears. An alternative hypothesis is that there are many more bears that are hungry, that are going in search of food, you know, and attracted by the sights and sounds of Churchill.
The answer lies in more research, but there are already signs 300 kilometres further north that Dr. Lan may be right. North of Churchill is the territory of Nunavut and the town of Aviat, where most inhabitants are Indigenous Inuit. The local language is Inuktitut, and on Sundays that includes hymns and the Bible. This community has lived off the land for centuries, and the key to that existence has always been the seal. Former church pastor Jimmy Makpa is also one of Aviat's most respected seal hunters. We're out in the water today in the hunt for ringed seals, a favourite with both polar bears and Inuit hunters. Not a seal in sight. In fact, conservationists now believe there'll be fewer seals in the future because global warming is killing them.
We consider the ring seal an indicator species because it's the most numerous marine mammal in the Arctic, and it's very dependent on the sea ice. So if there's going to be a loss of sea ice, that'll be one of the first marine mammals to show these changes.
And from the past collections of seals that Arviat has provided us,
Canadian Fisheries Officer Steve Ferguson has secured the consent of Arviat elders for hunters to help his research.
There's something bad happening in that spring, and just about all the seal pups are dying.
When the ringed seals are caught, their organs will be bagged and sent for examination. A picture will grow of the age, condition, and reproduction of the seals, all clues to the fate of their missing young.
The indication now is that snow may be a very important characteristic, that the amount of snowfall is important to protect the pups. The females have their young underneath these little snow dens, and if there's not enough snow for them, that they may be exposed to the cold or to predators like polar bears and Arctic foxes.
For the Inuit, it may mean the survival of a species that has contributed to their own survival.
The hunters that live in these communities depend on the seals and the other marine mammals for food. It's culturally important to them as well as economically important. So we want to ensure that they have that that lifestyle through the climate changes.
There are times when even the best hunters come home empty-handed. No seals today for Jimmy Makpa. As he heads home, the land behind him is littered with stone pillars called inukshuk, signposts that guide Inuit across this barren place. If Nick Lunn is right, the polar bear itself is an inukshuk, pointing the way to a devastating loss affecting us all.
I just see them as a very charismatic species, very intelligent, very smart. For me to think that we may lose that is just a sense of sort of sadness, I guess. If I figure that I'm working on a species that may no longer be around down the road, it's sort of like, you know, working on the dodo or, you know, some of the other species that have gone extinct in recent times.